Hi everyone, my name is Anita and I welcome you all on Inkpothub Media once again. Today is a very interesting day because I am at SPJIMR. I'm going to be speaking with Professor Varun Nagaraj, who is the Dean of the school, and I'm so excited to speak about his journey and the research program at SPGEN Institute of Management and Research.
Professor Varun Nagaraj,
thank you so much for accepting our request and giving your time for this interaction which we are going to have. And your journey is extremely inspirational. You are an alumni of IIT Bombay and you have done your master's in computer science engineering and then your MBA from Boston University and then PhD from Weatherhead School of Management. Now you're heading this institute. How does it feel? And I would also like to know about your journey before we move further in this interaction.
Thank you, Anita. First of all, thank you for you making the journey to come and visit with us.
Thank you so much.
You know, post-COVID, it's nice to be resuming some sense of normal life. So thank you for being here.
Thank you.
If you sort of look at where I've been so far, it could seem like a somewhat of a random walk, but I don't think it really has been that random as it might appear. If there's been one thing that has motivated me throughout, I would sort of say, the time I got into IIT, it's always been a sense for trying to get new experiences. So when I was at IIT, I probably spent far more time doing things outside the classroom than I should have been doing. And it was partially because IIT had so much to offer by way of new things that you could go experience. And I think that desire to just learn new things and see new things and experience new things has driven me throughout. So my decision, post IIT, I got into, the IIMs, but I also got into a program in the United States to go do my master's in engineering. And, that just seemed like a bigger adventure, and so off I went there.
Yeah.
And subsequent to that, all of my career changes have never been premeditated. I've never once changed a job for a CTC or a pay-based thing. I've always changed a job because it seemed like an interesting, fun, different thing to do. So I had a career that began as an engineer at Hewlett-Packard. For 7 years, I worked on, pretty interesting stuff. I feel proud of having actually invented one thing in the medical electronics area that was quite pioneering for its time, back in the early 90s or so. I did my MBA because I realized when I was an engineer that the few interactions I was having with customers were actually giving me a lot more thrill than me sitting by myself coding out new protocols. And so I did my MBA, and post my MBA, it seemed like the logical thing to do to go into management consulting because that's what you did once you finished your MBA. So I had a wonderful 7 years at a top-notch management consulting firm called PRTM, which then became part of PricewaterhouseCoopers. And there again, I loved my time as a consultant. I was one of the faster path to partner guys. So I made partner in about 5 years or so. And then I realized that, the climb up the hill was actually much more interesting than the view from the hill. And again, from a sense of adventure, that's kind of when the dot-com, boom was happening. So I became one of the few people who made partner and then decided to quit my partnership to go join a startup.
Okay.
Which was pretty unusual for its time because, being a partner is a fairly lucrative kind of a thing. But as I said, I've always been motivated by new things that actually seem like they might be fun to do. So that started a fairly long, almost I'd say 18-year stint in tech, but in sort of a startup type of context. I was in Boston, working for a company where, again, I think we invented a brand new category of product. So you'll find a lot of the common theme for me is around innovation and product invention. Because I fundamentally, maybe that's the IITian in me that never went away. I fundamentally think of myself as a product guy or a product person, right? And so the first company, we did some really amazing stuff. The things that you see today that are possible on the internet by way of making sure that traffic is managed just right and your delivery of receptions are just right was because of a pioneering product that, my company and I did in back then as my first move from management consulting to tech. From then, I decided it was time to go to California because, Boston was fun, but California seemed like more action was going on there.
True.
So I moved to California then. And I had a couple of roles where I worked in a slightly larger company as vice president of products. And then I moved into the startup world and I was the CEO of a couple of startups. Some of them ended well, some of them ended poorly, but that's the nature of startups. So, I'm very, very familiar with failure, more familiar with failure than success, which actually makes you a stronger person because
absolutely.
You think of it and say, well, what's the worst thing that can happen? I could fail. I've failed before. It's okay. So I did a couple of startups. I was also the CEO of a small public company, so that gave me a sense of what it is, you know, to run a company as sort of the face of the company to the public markets as well. So a whole different aspect than what you do with a startup where you're mostly dealing with venture capitalists and so on. Now, during all of this time, as I was moving things around, I always knew I wanted to somehow end up in academia in some manner. You know, it was a very vague idea. Didn't really have a good sense of what that even meant. So I started my PhD when I turned 50. You know, I was working as a CEO of this small public company, and my daughter started her college. And when she was on her college tours, I told her, hey, and she and I were traveling around the United States checking out different colleges for her. She was in her 11th grade or 11th standard. And I said, well, Dad needs to check out a few colleges too. And her biggest concern was I would go to the same college that she was planning to go to. So I said I would not be that obnoxious a father. And so we actually started our you know, school at the same time. She went to Rice University in Texas. I went to Case Western to a very nice program over there. So I continued as a CEO for a little bit, but that was difficult to do. So I did become a full-time student. And then at the end of my PhD, again, I didn't really have a specific goal in mind. So I went back into Silicon Valley, back to a startup, doing the things I was doing, trying to figure out what that transition to academia would mean. In the meantime, I was teaching some. I taught at Pepperdine University, at University of Notre Dame, realized I actually quite like it. I took some of my PhD thesis work and began turning those into, you know, published
those research papers, yes.
And that was fun. But I really wasn't sure what the fit for me was. And then I got a call from a friend at SPJIMR who basically sort of said, hey, would you be interested in at least being considered for the role of a dean at SPJIMR? And he pointed out that the search firm had not shortlisted me simply because my profile didn't quite fit. They had shortlisted your traditional folks, you know, people who are deans of other business schools in India, actually a couple of associate deans from the United States. And he said, I can add you to that mix, even though you don't fit at all. I said, sure, it can't hurt. And so he added me to the mix. I interviewed and I said, hey, this could be an interesting option where my CEO skills could still be deployed on a daily basis, running an institution, and I get to do some other fun stuff. So that's basically how, you know, I embraced the selection process, and I was fortunate enough, you know, to get picked. And my wife had moved to India on her own teaching mission, if you will, and so it made sense for me to be here. My children were out of the home. They're both in college. One's in medical school. One's in environmental science. So empty nester. So it seemed like a good chance. Again, from an adventure point of view, as I said.
So you're here in India now.
I'm here in India. And, you know, you wouldn't think of India as an adventure. But for me, after 35 years in the United States, it is an adventure. Being in academia is an adventure because I've never been in academia before. So I like the unknown. I like the unfamiliar. And in fact, even my PhD thesis was very much around the unknown and the unfamiliar. You know, I was always curious to see, how do teams learn about situations they know nothing about, right? You know, how do you basically just go, you know, in an uncertain environment, unfamiliar environment, and learn what you need to know at a pace that's rapid enough for you to do something different? So in a sense, one could argue the PhD thesis sort of encapsulated my own existential crisis, if you will.
Okay, so it is towards leadership, it is towards technology, it is towards design, and So more or less like what you are publishing and what you are experiencing now. So when you came back to India, and Indian research scenario is very different. So what do you think, like, what are the key drivers for Indian research ecosystem? If you can throw some light on that aspect.
Sure thing. And I'll start off with actually the American research ecosystem. Because there are lessons there that I hope we in the Indian research ecosystem can learn from. See, I think the American management research ecosystem has got it wrong to some degree. Business schools began to follow, for status and prestige purposes, the same set of criteria that scientific research followed. So, therefore, publishing for publishing's sake, or studying a problem with a huge amount of rigor, this is how basically you do it in physics and chemistry and so forth. And the general joke in American academia is anybody who's outside the physics department has physics envy, meaning you want to show you're as smart as the physics people, that you deploy research methodologies as intense and deep as the physicists and so on. But that's a wrong way to go about doing it, because you end up studying problems that may have really no bearing on society. Management is a profession, right? Physics is a science. It is absolutely fine for a physicist to look at string theory because they're trying to unravel the mysteries of the cosmos. Nobody should ever ask a physicist, how is this practically applicable? That's the wrong question. That's science. But when you're in management research, you have to ask the question, how is this relevant to the practice of management? See, so you cannot base management research on the same forms of research that you base physical science research on. But I think to a large degree, most American universities have unfortunately followed that pattern with their obsession on research.
Mm-hmm.
And so my criticism on American management research is that it is driven heavily by a quest for rigor and proving that it is, you know, intellectually rigorous, and oftentimes ignores the reason why management, frankly, management profession should exist or management education should exist, which is to look at the real life problems that managers have. And a lot of the research, I would say 70-80% of the research, leaves me cold as a practitioner.
Mm-hmm.
So you would think that as a CEO who's been a CEO for, you know, 30-35 years, who's been in practice for 30-35 years, I should be able to look at most management papers and say, you know, these things make sense to me. But 80% of them don't, right? I look at it and say, I don't know who used this stuff. And just because it is brilliant and mathematically rigorous to me is not sufficient. So the notion of relevance to me is a very important aspect. And certainly the Academy of Management, you know, is talking a lot more about it. But it always is rigor and relevance. It's never relevance and rigor. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And so to me, if I look at sort of the lessons that Indian management education and management research can take away, I would hope that they flip that around,
mm-hmm.
that they focus on relevance that is backed by rigor, rather than rigorous output that might have some relevance.
So I want to know now from you that because SPJIMR is also having the FPM program here, so how you are going to incorporate your learnings from fallacies of American system in your system here? So how will you take it forward? How will you bring that rigor and relevance both here in this Indian context?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. You know, I think SPJMR is in actually a good position to sort of hopefully focus on these two at least equally, if not more, on relevance, if you will. And the reason is SPJMR has always been very practice oriented. You know, SPJMR was set up, you know, its mission statement, and I don't know, as you walk around,
we have seen it.
You know, is to influence practice.
Hmm.
So I think SPJMR is very much set up around the ethos saying, you know, our job is to make sure that the practices of managers and organizations is really what we are trying to influence. So which means any new knowledge we create better serve a purpose in that particular direction. So that would be sort of, I think, the mission itself, I think, guides the FPM program. And therefore, I think when FPM scholars come in, I would hope that they look at SPJMR as an institution that's committed to advancing practice.
Mm-hmm.
But advancing practice with the standards of rigor that are required. Now, I would hope that being at SPJMR, surrounded by faculty members, you know, who at SPJMR actually are a lot more like me than you would imagine, in the sense that we have a large number of faculty members who have spent years in practice. Many of them have done their PhDs late in life.
Hmm.
We also have wonderful faculty members who are career academics or academicians. They've come out of the IIMs with their PhD programs like you did. They've worked on interesting research problems. So you have this blend of people here at SPJMR, you know, what you might consider sort of the classic academicians, and then you've got these industry-oriented academics. In fact, I think there's a book on my table here called Voices of Practitioner Scholars in Management. And this is from Case Western Reserve University.
Yeah.
This is the school I did my
PhD
at.
From.
And this was a very important focus there. That is, you know, when you are coming up with research topics, look at the problems of practice.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, what we refer to, or what FPM scholars refer to, as RQs, or research questions, right?
Mm.
At Case Western, we always used to start with the notion of what is the POP? What is the problem of practice? And from the problem of practice, you derive the research question. See, there again, you know, when you're talking of relevance and rigor, a rigor approach would be, I study the literature, I identify a gap in literature, and I say, hey, that's a publishable opportunity by addressing that gap. And then I study the gap, I provide some piece of knowledge that addresses the gap, I try and get something published. But maybe that gap in knowledge exists because nobody cares, right? So what's the point of going and filling a gap in knowledge if nobody cares? It's far more important to sort of say, what do people care about? And whose people? It's not other academics, it's the practice. Is those who are in practice. And so beginning with the problem of practice, and then translating that into a research question, which hopefully also addresses a gap in literature, I think is basically the right way to go about
it. Okay. So when we talk about SPGEN's FPM program, what are those three things which you would like to talk in terms of idiosyncrasies of the program itself?
Okay. I think that's a fair question, right? I think at one level, and I don't know if it's an idiosyncrasy, but I do want to emphasize it, We encourage our FPM scholars to come in with their ideas and form their ideas here and find the faculty members that they feel are a good fit.
Okay.
And a lot of good business schools do that, but I do want to emphasize that, because there are also business schools where, you know, you get paired with the faculty and you're essentially, you know, you're extending that faculty member's research, you know, and that happens quite a bit in many other programs as well. So I think the notion of actually coming in, you know, with that kind of freedom is an important part. The second part that I think that makes us kind of different is the fact that we have this focus, as I said, on practice, right? And I hope that FPM scholars enjoy the fact that they are going to be in an environment where, you know, the measure of success is, did it actually influence practice versus did you simply get published? You know, we want you to get published and influence practice. We also have at SPJIMR, as you have noticed, a very important and critical emphasis on the social sector and on social outcomes, right? Compared to many other business schools, we were probably amongst the much more progressive ones that embrace the concepts and even use language like responsible management, positive impact, and so forth. We run our own NGO. We basically work with 500 other NGOs, you know, on different kinds of research projects. So FPM students who are interested either in impacting practice of companies or of the social sector, I would hope see SPJIMR as an interesting place that would intellectually challenge them and bring them in. Once they're in, I think we actually provide a pretty nice ecosystem of folks. So one, I talked to you already about sort of the faculty mix, right? Perhaps much more than maybe the IIMs and other institutions, we have many more practitioners who are also academics, like myself, at SPJIMR, right? And I'd hope that brings together a slightly different viewpoint. We have a lot of young classic academics and, you know, who are coming from the best institutions in India and abroad, and we have obviously the practitioners. We are on a campus that has a couple of engineering colleges, so in that sense we have faculty members here who collaborate with SP Institute of Technology, which is just down 100 yards away from our front entrance here. So that gives us a university feel, which isn't something that a pure Indian Institute of Management enjoys, right? So we're able to look at problems of practice that may actually require more than just a management school to go solve. We have very carefully curated and picked four centers, and most universities will call it centers of excellence. We don't, we call it centers of practice.
I wanted to ask about these centers, so because there are four centers, I heard.
So why are they centers of practice? See, universities create centers sometimes as temples to a given faculty member. You know, a faculty member steps up and says, I've been here long enough, I want to create a center, and then they'll create a center for something or the other, right? And they'll call it a center of excellence. And that is certainly the one way to do it. The other way to do it is to sort of say, listen, a center's job is really to be the interface between the institute and the outside world. So that's how I look at a center. So to me, a center is an outward-facing institution or an outward-facing entity that identifies a target demographic in the outside world and tries to channel the institute's capabilities and capabilities from outside the institute towards that particular target segment. So each of our centers tries to focus on a particular target, which means we understand that ecosystem of practitioners really well, right? And again, when you're talking of influencing practice, you have to understand who that practitioner base is that you're going after and really build a deep understanding of that practitioner. And saying a manager is a practitioner is not specific enough. For example, if you're running a small to medium enterprise in a family business context, which is what most of the small to medium enterprises are, that is basically an ecosystem or a community whose practices you could influence. If you are basically in the NGO sector, or you are an innovator that's trying to come up with sustainable development imperatives, that is a clear group of people you could try and influence. If you are a leadership and development executive in a large corporation, and you're trying to infuse classic Indian values and wisdom traditions, and also other Eastern and Western wisdom traditions into leadership, that is a clear demographic that you're going after. So our four centers target very clear end customers, right? And maybe that's the corporate person in me, that your product needs to be, there needs to be a product market fit. And so I look at it probably not as an academic, I look at it probably as an industry practitioner. So saying which target markets would we want to influence? And that's what our four centers try and do. So I think these are the reasons why FPM scholars or aspiring scholars should consider SPJIMR. I think they will find a very different environment here and a fair amount of close attention, because it's not a particularly large program, and a good opportunity, I think, to work with a range of faculty and centers and other colleges that happen to be on campus as well.
So you have already covered a vast range of things around research ecosystem here at SPJIMR. Considering rigor, research, relevance, all these aspects together, what are your long-term plans for the program?
See, the world around us is changing.
Huh. Right?
And I think, yes, it's fashionable and everybody would use the word VUCA, you know, for volatile and uncertain and complex and adapting and adaptive and so forth, which is true. Or ambiguous, sorry, is what the A is. But I think there's a more fundamental moral question, which is the world around us fair or not, right? And I think one would agree that the world around us is imperfect, right? We have certainly not achieved perfection as a society. So rather than worry about VUCA, if you just looked at the world and said, this is an imperfect world, which is also changing, which means there's an opportunity to try and make it a little less imperfect. Because if the world was static and the world was imperfect, it would remain imperfect. But if the world is imperfect, but it's changing, you at least have an opportunity to try and make it less imperfect. Now, what is the way through which you can achieve, you know, the slight improvement in perfection, if you will? It's through innovation.
Hmm.
And to me, therefore, when I look at SPJIMR over a 5-year, over a 10-year horizon, I think what we need to do is to really make sure that we as an institute are able to, and this is a phrase I like to use, advance wise innovation. So I'll talk about that at some length here. Innovation, because I believe that's the only way to make change happen. And innovation, by innovation, I mean a solution, right? Solutions for problems that we're facing that make the world a slightly less imperfect place. And an innovative solution is something that is useful, right? And something that is novel and new and unique and so on. Now, why do I use the word wise innovation? What does that mean? Wise innovation to me is, you know, I use the word wise in two ways. It's wise in that the way in which the innovation was created was wise, meaning it took a lot of opinions and perspectives into consideration. There was a period of reflection to figure out, you know, what do these all mean? There was an attempt at being inclusive. And there was basically an attempt at not overreacting to any certain situation, right? So there is a wisdom in how you approach the problem. There is also wisdom in whether the solution is a wise solution or not. Did the solution achieve good outcomes, right? Did the solution provide you not just individual economic gain, did it benefit society in some manner? Did it benefit your fellow human in some manner? Did it benefit the planet, the environment? So wise innovation to me is really about both how the innovation was made and what the result of the innovation was. And I think you need both, because we are surrounded by innovation, let's say from my own old home in Silicon Valley, that is totally unwise. You know, one would argue that a lot of social media based innovation has not necessarily been well thought through, right? The implications of innovation have not been thought through. The implications of what the Facebook like button and what the WhatsApp share button would do were not well thought out. They are terrible examples of innovation, in my opinion, right? They are unwise innovations. So I think if we as an institute can figure out a way of advancing wise innovation, right? Because advancing, I don't want us to be sitting in an ivory tower just thinking. I want results to happen. So if you're looking at advancing wise innovation, as an educational institution, what are our tools? One of our outputs are our students. So one part which is integral to who SPJIMR is, which is hopefully India's best teaching institute, I would hope we continue to bring out students who not only are appreciated for what they are today, which is, you know, they're mature, they're grounded, they're empathetic, and these are the attributes that people assign to our students, and I would hope to retain all of that. But I would also hope that these students increasingly see themselves as problem solvers. They're fearless, bold, risk-taking, taking on challenges that others would shy away from. That would be the add-on or the increment I would like to add to our student output, right? Build on a very, very solid, wonderful base, but add on these additional dimensions that I think are necessary to advance wise innovation. So that's going to require a change in curriculum. It's going to require a change in pedagogy. It's going to require a change in the experiences we expose our students to. It might require a change even in the programs we go after. You know, so in addition to the traditional kinds of MBA programs, there are probably other forms of delivery to create this kind of student who goes after innovation with this kind of gusto. The second way in which we as an institute can advance wise innovation is through our thought leadership, right? Not necessarily just through our students, but through our thought leadership, which then creates a force multiplier, meaning it impacts many more people than just the people you teach. And I would hope that the research that we put out, if it is relevant, and if our centers package them well and basically take them to those four ecosystems, results in really a non-linear increase in terms of the amount of impact that we have. So So what do I see are sort of a 10-year North Star? I would like to see SPJIMR as being the institution that is advancing wise innovation,
mm-hmm.
with the definitions I've provided to you. And I'd like to see us do it through our teaching mission,
mm-hmm.
and I'd like to see us do it through our thought leadership mission. Will the institute look the same as it does today? Probably not, right? I mean, that
Absolutely.
Would be probably a sign of failure if we look exactly the same 10 years from now as we do today. But do I know exactly what that configuration looks like 10 years from now? No, not really. But that's the part why I think the adventure ride I've had through my career makes me comfortable with the fact that I don't really know what we will look like 2 or 3 years from now, and that's okay.
You already know the variables which are going to lead you to achieve the vision. Yes.
We'll probably fail on a few things. We'll probably launch Absolutely. A couple of initiatives that fail. But, you know, as I said, I'm no stranger to failure. I think I'll be able to deal with that. Our institution will be able to deal with that, learn from that, and do something else that is even better the next time. So I'm excited about the 10-year path. But if you ask me too much about the specifics, I would sort of say,
okay. So I'm very curious to ask you one more question.
Yeah.
Or who is going to be an ideal fellow SPJIMR?
Okay. Look, I've met with our FPM group, and there's many in our current group that sort of exemplify the type of person that we want. So to me, an ideal FPM scholar, and then I'm also thinking as a recent PhD myself, right, even though I'm old and ancient and all that, but as a recent PhD myself, I think about the classmates I enjoyed having the most within my cohort. And these were people that were basically curious, right? Mm. I think curiosity is a very understated thing, because if you're curious, you will learn. If you're not curious, you won't learn, right? And being fearless is the other part, right? If you're curious and fearless, you're basically not going to be constrained by some tiny problem. You're going to aim, you're going to fail, and it's okay. So I would love to have FPM students that are curious about some particular topic, that are fearless about their pursuit of that particular topic, you know, and they and us are both willing to tolerate failure. But their end goal, they have a North Star, right? There is something that they want to influence. There is some big problem that they're trying to solve. It's those kinds of people that I think would be wonderful to have as FPM scholars here.
Okay. So it was lovely interacting with you. Before I move forward, I'm going to do a rapid fire with you, because we have had a very, you know, serious and intriguing conversation now. So this fun conversation, I would like to know you as a person in routine days. Okay. First question to you, what is your early morning routine?
Am I allowed to have different routines for different days?
You can tell. So
there are three things that I like to do in the morning, and I generally alternate between them. So one is I get onto my spin bicycle and try and, you know, work up a sweat with a high interval training. That's very much the Californian in me, right? You have to basically get your HIIT training in. The second one is I'm actually a fan of Econ Talks, which is a podcast that Russ Roberts of Stanford and Shalom College runs. So that's a good one, usually with a more relaxed walk. So it's, you can't do high interval training every day. And the third one is, you know, believe it or not, I just like to have coffee and listen to MS Subbulakshmi Suprabhatam.
Okay.
And on certain mornings. So it's really a cycling between those.
Okay.
Those three things.
Next question. A must-have item on your work desk.
Well, the concept of a work desk has gone away because your laptop is your work desk, I guess. So maybe the first question is, what's the wallpaper you have, you know, on your laptop? And the wallpaper I have on my laptop, and you might sort of say, hey, you know, it's somewhat unfair, is that of my children. These are my kids when they were young and small and beautiful, and now they're older and still beautiful. So, you know, my daughter is 24, my son is 19, but, you know, this reminds me of the innocent days back then. So that, and of course, I shouldn't forget my beautiful wife. So those would be the essentials on my
Great. So what's your latest purchase to increase your productivity?
Probably maybe the juicer. I got a Nutribullet juicer.
Okay.
Because, you know, that gets from, and why am I including it as a productivity thing? Because it allows you to get your breakfast prepared in about 40 seconds, right? So I'm a smoothie guy, and this wasn't one I had used before. So this is a brand I bought here. I must say I'm a fan of the Nutribullet smoothie maker.
Okay. What is your favorite book?
So different on the fiction and non-fiction side. So I read pretty widely. On the fiction side, I have a range of interests, many of who are Indian-American authors of different kinds, but also go back to the classics and American authors. But if there was one, sorry, in a slightly morbid way, if you told me what is the last book you would like to read before you passed off from this earth, it would probably be amongst the things that gave me the most joy, you know, all through my youth, which would be P.G. Wodehouse. So PG Wodehouse and Jeeves, you know, I think those are evergreen. So unfortunately, I don't think the younger generation is aware of them to the same degree. My kids didn't ever read PG Wodehouse, but PG Wodehouse is, I think, what I would go with.
Okay, last question. Which quote keeps you motivated all the time?
Well, you've got probably two, and they're going to sound odd. The first one, maybe not so odd. The first one really is, you know, what Socrates is supposed to have said just before he got executed, you know, which is a unexamined life is not worth living, right? And that's the foundation of philosophy. And to me, honestly, management, science, and research, and everything is about answering some fairly fundamental questions that have meaning, right? Mm-hmm. And so the notion of always examining something, always questioning, you know, why is this the way it is, never taking things for granted, you know, it was, you know, you could argue which part of civilization from which part of the world, you know, should take credit for philosophy. I'm an equal opportunity philosopher. I think you can equally give credit to the Greeks as you can to the Indians, as you can to the Egyptians and so on. But on the Greek side, at least the notion that life needs to be examined, I think was a pretty critical aspect. So Socrates would be the one.
Okay.
On the other side, but you know, just thought and thinking with no action isn't quite worth it. So if you look from an action point of view, the stuff that actually I think of is from Mike Tyson, who was a boxer. So Mike Tyson was the most fearsome boxer of his generation till he got exposed as not being that great a boxer, right? But during the time he was, you know, the heavyweight champion of the world, he was just unbeatable. And people would often come to him and say, hey, your next opponent says that he has a perfect plan to fight you. And Mike Tyson's quote was, everybody has a plan until they get hit for the first time, right? And that was absolutely true. And why is that relevant to us in business? It basically means we can plan all we want. It will never proceed according to plan, right?
Absolutely.
And therefore, you're going to get hit no matter what. But that's just the way it is. You know, you got to pick yourself up. Now, I could have probably picked a more motivational thing about picking yourself up once you get hit. But I've always loved the Mike Tyson quote about everybody has a plan until they get hit.
It was wonderful speaking with you, Professor Varun. I really enjoyed and thoroughly learned a lot of other things which are from your leadership perspective, from institute's perspective, coming from corporate world and then academic world. It's really inspiring and inspirational. Thank you so much for your time.
And thank you to you and your crew for taking the time to visit with us.